The production of this video was made possible by donors to the Orchestration Online Patreon initiative. Please consider adding your support to the creation of free educational internet resources by visiting our Patreon page linked below.
That is precisely what I wrote! You understand? Huh? I write, you play.
Gentlemen, if we might pick it up from the bar before 104.
If the work continues like this, Igor, the result will be something great. I know what the Rite of Spring will be when everything is as we both want it. New, and for an ordinary viewer, a jolting impression and emotional experience. For some, it will open new horizons flooded with different rays of sun. People will see new and different colors and different lines, all different, new and beautiful. Václav Nijinsky, January 1913.
Hey there, this is your orchestration tutor, Thomas Goss. A few months ago, our historical survey of the original production of The Rite of Spring left off with the final formation of its creative team. Stravinsky as composer, Nicholas Rurik as set and costume designer, as well as anthropological expert in ancient Russia, Sergei Diaghilev as impresario, and Václav Nijinsky as choreographer. At the time we pick up the story, ballet master and choreographic genius Mikhail Fokin has left the Ballet Russe company, and the ascendancy of Nijinsky as the star choreographer of Afternoon of a Faun. There could be no greater difference between two virtuoso dancers than Fokin and Nijinsky. Fokin was outgoing, a commanding presence while setting his choreography, with supreme confidence in his own genius. Nijinsky was shy, often inarticulate when trying to express his ideas to his fellow dancers, and prone to simply repeat the artistic pronouncements of others around him just to be polite, or to seem involved. Fokin had spent a full decade at the Imperial Russian Ballet School, building his reputation one masterpiece at a time, until he exploded on the Western world as the greatest ballet master in its experience. Despite Nijinsky's utter superiority to any other male dancer, though, his greatest claim to fame up to 1912 was as a tool of the ambitions and creativity of others. He had zero experience as an authority figure, and because of his purely solo roles, very little camaraderie with rank-and-file company dancers. But his intimate relationship with Diaghilev brought him into frequent contact with Stravinsky, who came to respect him, and, after the scandalous triumph of Afternoon of a Faun, to trust him as a choreographer. The chief thing to understand about the final stage of production for The Rite of Spring is that it was an enormously busy time for the company. Much of it was spent on tour across Europe, with Nijinsky dancing, demanding lead roles night after night, and then in the mornings working with the company on his slow, often confusing choreography. Stravinsky, who had been left exhausted by the completion of the score, wasn't given much time to rest before Diaghilev was begging him to join the company on tour to work with Nijinsky in making the music clearer to the dancers, and to help Nijinsky himself understand it. The way Stravinsky describes this period is probably the most dishonest section of his autobiography. The vast amount of rehearsals necessary were probably very welcome to everyone involved, especially in view of the complexity of the production, and not a sign of Nijinsky's incompetence. Far from Stravinsky's supposed disappointment written of in the book with the choreography, he had nothing but glowing things to say about it as it was created, not only in complimenting Nijinsky during rehearsals, but also in correspondence to his friends and colleagues. And though Stravinsky of 1935 scoffed at Dahlkroze's principle that every aspect of a musical work's rhythm should be interpreted in dance, in 1913 he was completely on board with the concept. In short, Stravinsky was thoroughly, even joyously complicit in everything of which he was later to accuse Nijinsky. Rurik was no less invested in the process. He would often visit Nijinsky's Rite of Spring rehearsals, and his presence was enough to calm any tense situation. He gave the young choreographer a boost of much-needed confidence in his work, and helped encourage him to make the dance even more authentic along the lines of what was understood about ancient Russia through art and archaeology. Rurik often brought along artwork that he'd painted or sketched, showing his costume designs in progress, or his conceptions of ancient rituals. It was enough to refocus the work back upon its purpose, which probably helped the dancers as much as it helped Nijinsky. It's worth taking the time to look at how precisely Nijinsky realized the scenario concocted by Rurik and Stravinsky, and even found more personal meanings in it. When you put the original choreography next to the score, the Ballet Russe's approach of Gesamtkunstwerk becomes all the more obvious for the Rite of Spring. Although there was a definite attempt made to completely avoid the intensely mimed acting of Petrushka, each ritual in the Rite of Spring has definite actions by the corps of dancers. The score may have inspired hundreds of abstract works of music by other composers, but there was never anything abstract about the original intentions of Stravinsky or his collaborators. This isn't just patently obvious, but it's also a great way of understanding the construction and even the orchestration of the Rite of Spring. After the introduction to Part 1, the first dance is called The Augurs of Spring, which Stravinsky and Rurik were originally calling The Divination with Twigs. The concept was that at the very beginning of the ritual, a wise elder would divine or predict the future by casting sticks upon the ground and reading their shape. Stravinsky conceived the huge rhythmic pulse to start with, and then gradually developed a melody to fit the scenario as he imagined the dancing of the 300-year-old woman. As he wrote to Rurik,
"She is constantly before my eyes as I compose. I see her running in front of the group, stopping them sometimes, and interrupting the rhythmic flow."
Another great example is the dramatic arc that connects the second half of the first part. The music of the Ritual of Rival Tribes depicts a mock battle, with extremely aggressive gestures meant to evoke the spontaneity of ancient warfare, rather than today's clichés of marching in perfect battalions to trumpets and drums. Right into the middle of this, Stravinsky introduces four tubas playing a unison processional melody in counterpoint with octave horns. In anticipation of the next section, which, as we studied a while back, is essentially an add-on to this dance. It's unique in that the mock battle elements are stripped away, just leaving the procession of tubas and horns, and everything that supports them. After the procession has introduced the oldest and wisest one to the center of the stage, the music explodes in reaction, but then comes to a sudden halt. In the very shortest section of the rite, a mere four bars, the sage kisses the earth, and then raises his hands to the sky. The music erupts with excitement, even more fiercely than before. Apparently, Stravinsky composed all of this in a white heat, especially the very last section. As we put the score next to the choreography once again, notice how Nijinsky realizes all this action. The mock battle, though spontaneous looking to match the music, still has very organized mass structures.
Thank you.
When the horns and tubas announce the approach of the sage, this organization seems to fall apart, but then the dancers form a square around center stage. When the sage arrives, the dancers go into frenzied spasms where they stand, swept away by the rapture of the moment. After the kiss of the earth, the dancers seem to explode across the stage, just like the music. But actually, once again just like the music, they're dancing a very complicated set of interacting moves in and around one another. Last month, we studied the circle of the adolescents. And later on in this lesson, we'll take a look at the next section of Part 2, the glorification of the Chosen One. Let's take a moment now to see how the music laid the groundwork for the choreography and dramatic meaning. At the start of the circle dance, the music is very decidedly paced, with a highly original contrast between naturalistic folk elements and harrowing suspense. The pacing suggests an almost clockwork intricacy of motion. A first interruption by stopped horns brings the music to a temporary halt. The second interruption, though, is not ignored, and the music opens out with extreme violence, bridging into the next section with 11 bass drum hits, timpani strikes, and downbows in a row. The glorification and evocation that follow are not only savagely rhythmic, but they outline sections for specific ritual gestures. Nijinsky crafted extremely complex, interwoven dances for the adolescents. So intricate that it's a wonder that only the Chosen One trips up. Throughout, Nijinsky matches the suspense by making these beautiful sequences look like they're danced right on the edge of what's possible, and then adds a touch of carelessness to amp up the tension even higher. As the Chosen One interweaves in the deadly game, she trips up to the stopped horns. Once is forgivable. twice means that she's been chosen by the gods for sacrifice, and the other girls whirl her around to the center of the circle, turning abruptly from thoughtful, intricate cogs in a puzzle to a crowd of mean girls on a prehistoric playground. Notice how every phrase is interpreted with ritual meaning by Nijinsky, all underlining the fearsome choice that the gods have made, culminating with complete prostration before the sacrificial maiden. Everyone on the creative team contributed a wholly original and personal element to the Rite of Spring. Stravinsky's role as composer and originator of the idea was, of course, the greatest. Rurik gave the work shape, context, visual meaning, and cultural credibility. Diaghilev contributed his original touch by setting into motion conditions that would ensure that the premiere would be explosive rather than just another night at the ballet. Nijinsky, too, brought something original to the idea of the Rite of Spring, over and above his efforts to channel the music into choreography. For years, he'd been sort of a chosen one himself. His actions had singled him out for glorification by the public, and they were only too happy to watch him dance himself to the point of his own destruction. He had reached the height of his abilities at a very young age, and there was little else left to do but continue at that pace until his physique or his mind betrayed him. Both eventualities of which he was aware as no one else seemed to be. There's something incredibly personal in the way that the Chosen One is humiliated even as she's glorified, and how she bewails her body and spirit starting to fall apart as she dances herself to death at the end. It's all the more evident when you consider that the role of the sacrificial maiden was originally intended to be his sister, who was like his other self, and essentially his equal in physical virtuosity. He was to express the sacrifice of his own career to the public through the vehicle of Bronislava Nijinska. It's ironic that decades later, the dancers were to remember their work on the choreography of the Rite of Spring with pride, while Stravinsky was to condemn it. During the rehearsals, it was actually the other way around. Stravinsky and Nijinsky were in complete accord as to the vision of the work, while the dancers proved recalcitrant. Nijinsky's choreography went against every principle they'd been trained to uphold. Their feet turned in instead of out. Their costumes were heavy and clinging instead of liberating. Every dance, except for the final sacrifice, involved group action that called no attention to the line of the body. Rather, it was motion and group posture that mattered. Diaghilev wisely brought in Marie Rambert, a disciple of Dalcroze and his philosophy of eurhythmics. She served both as ballet mistress, keeping order with the initially stubborn dancers, and as Nijinsky's amanuensis, covering the piano score with copious notations to preserve his ideas. Her strength was in establishing a system by which the dancers could count their way through the very complex rhythms of Stravinsky's music and not get lost. After a while, the dancers started calling her Miss Rhythmichka.
Paintings of the primitives in which the figures are twisted, the knees turned in, the arms bent outwards. Your faces must have no expression, but be as though asleep with the eyes open, like statues. There is no romance here, no individualism. It is a communal, depersonalized world, and though our ballet has grown from ancient tradition, it could perhaps be seen as a metaphor for the tragedy of modern life. We'll try again.
But circumstances were to only get more challenging. Nijinsky's plans suffered a major blow with the marriage and then pregnancy of his sister Bronislava. Marriage took away his sense of emotional reliance and intimate trust with his sister, and that was bad enough, but pregnancy ended her ability to dance his most personal role. It was like losing his right arm, not to mention a key ally in the production itself. To make matters worse, the Rite of Spring was costing a small fortune to rehearse. Diaghilev was sinking ever further into debt to keep his dancers paid during the endless succession of extra rehearsals required. On top of this were the 24 rehearsals that were needed by the orchestra, just to get their minds around the premiere of a work that used techniques, harmonies, and textures that were totally alien to most of them, including the conductor Pierre Monteux. The dancers' resistance to Nijinsky's demands often led to quite furious blow-ups, which Diaghilev would have to smooth over using all his charm and diplomacy, but even that was wearing thin. This is the time during which the personal relationship between Nijinsky and Diaghilev began to disintegrate irreparably. You can read the anger which Diaghilev's double-dealing and emotional dishonesty provoked in Nijinsky's diary, at its most resentful concerning the period around the Rite of Spring. Diaghilev had brought Nijinsky out of Russia and made him into a superstar as well as his own kept man, but the process of allowing his genius to emerge as a choreographer and ballet master was tearing this cozy little domestic illusion apart. But eventually, the dance was completely created and set on the company. The orchestra, after many dropouts, substitutions, and difficult rehearsals, was ready to perform. The theater was rented and renovated, to the point of tearing out the front rows to make room for the massive number of musicians required in the pit. And on the 29th of May, 1913, 1 year exactly from the premiere of Afternoon of a Faun, the Rite of Spring was ready to be released on the world. I'll return to the story of the Rite of Spring's genesis in next month's installment of this series, Riot and Aftermath. For now, though, let's jump over to some score analysis of one of the sections we just discussed, the glorification of the Chosen One. I have to say, I'm really enjoying going over the scores and explaining the Rite of Spring to you in terms of the cultural heritage. I don't think I would do that with every score. There are some things that are just obvious on the face of them, or the history of them is very simple, like the planets, for instance. I probably would spend a lot less time explaining things and just basically just do analyses on those kinds of scores. So anyhow, but it is really enjoyable to do both. So at least for this first series of Patreon score analyses, it's, you know, just really, really great to be going along with you through every step. Now, we're just going to do one more shorter section which I like to call the glorification of the Chosen One, which is how it used to be referred to before this edition came out. This is, I guess, based on a 1960s Russian edition, and when Dover did the translations and everything and set up the engraving on it and everything else for its U.S. or English language version, it decided to be very transliteral with all of the names, right? But I think the old one is actually better. The naming and honoring of the Chosen One seems a little, like, a bit hard to digest. I think the glorification is better, because that's really, if you look at the dance, that is what they are doing. They are going nuts over how incredible it is that this girl is going to sacrifice herself, right? And I call that glorification, as sinister as it might appear to us. An interesting thing, I'll just slip this tidbit in here because I don't know where else I'm going to put it, and that is that there are some anthropologists who feel that the whole idea of, like, a sacrifice, like a sacrificial virgin, is something that is more of a 20th century idea or 19th century idea, you know, this sort of concept that, you know, young maidens would be sacrificed to ancient sinister gods. I think that there might be something to that. And I think I remember reading somewhere that Rurik actually did not see that there was any merit to that whole idea of Stravinsky's. But I mean, if it was going to get the rest of the anthropological research that he accumulated into an artistic form, then he was probably going to go along with it, right? And also just to talk about the symbology of, you know, certain modern trends of thought and culture, right? Like you might remember from just a few minutes ago when the Riot at the Rite film portrays Marie Rambert explaining what she thinks the whole ballet is about to the dancers. So I would tend to agree with that, actually, that it really, you know, anything we do in the modern era is going to reflect what we think today much more so than it is going to be a recreation of something in the past, you know, because we have to find out what is interesting about it to us today, right? And that's what they were doing back then, 100 years ago. All right, so now on with the analysis with that sort of lengthy introduction there. The thing to know about the glorification of the Chosen One section of part two is that it really is in four parts. It sort of is constructed A, B, and C. Now, B goes into C. It's sort of like section B kind of has a sort of intermeshing structure with section C, which we'll check out in a few minutes. And then the A section comes back. So it's ABCA, essentially, or ABCBCBCA. All right. So really, there is not a whole lot to explain in terms of, like, overall orchestration, because what Stravinsky is doing here is really just severe cutting and pasting. And this is another thing that makes the Rite of Spring seem so savage, really, is that, like, he's got one perfectly constructed 2T bar, and then he just basically follows the next bar is exactly the same as the first bar. Then he's got this, this little interim kind of thumping kind of thing. And then he's got the first bar again, identical to the first two bars. He's got another one of those bars. Now here, it looks like he's doing something different, but he's actually going boom, chuck, boom, chuck, ba-da-dum, right? So he's just adding an extra couple of eighth beats onto the beginning, right? 5/8, 7/8. And then here, he's basically doing that same idea, right? It's five beats, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? But he's stretching out over this because he has a big swoop up to here, right? So check it out. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So this is one full phrase of this, right? But it is coinciding with this bar of 4/8 here so that you can land here on this more of these chunka bars, okay? Now, these bars are not exactly the same, all right? They have a very similar pulse. And that's because they're structured, like the orchestration is structured in a similar way to a degree. But definitely, these are much more, I would say, much more savage than these. Okay, so we'll figure out how that all works as we go along. So let's just start with the construction of this bar, this amazing bar. Okay, so he's got A3 bassoons, A2 contrabassoons, right? That is going to be a massive sound, and it is a staccatissimo, right? So it's just really boom. And the same thing here. And he's saying non divisi on these basses, right? So that's very easy because the bass is tuned the bass is tuned E, A, D, G, or this could be a C extension down here if you want. If you look at the Rite at the Rite movie, you will see that that one of the bassists has a C extension there in the background, and they were around way back then. Okay, so yeah, I mean, you know, some of those big romantic composers wanted those low C's, and they accommodated them with C extensions. All right, so but here you can just have this open A string and then finger the A up there on the D string, right? And it just really gives a big bright sound, boom. And then just still holding down that D string, just hitting that same A, right? Okay, so that is what's going on here. And if you look at it, really, like, that is the only time that the contrabassoons and bassoons play that octave, right? In these, it's just really right at the beginning of the bum bum ba-da-dum. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention the tubas are doubling the bassoon and contrabassoons, right? So that's what's nice about having, you know, a higher and a lower tuba in a massive work like this. I have to say that if I were scoring, you know, if I had unlimited budget and they were saying, hey, Thomas, look, we want you to score a work with quintuple winds and, you know, eight horns and as big a, you know, as big a brass section as you want, I would definitely go for two tubas. I would probably do the whole Planets idea of having a tenor tuba and a bass tuba, because I think that that makes a really, really interesting combination. So, or bass tuba and euphonium, if you want to talk about practicalities. So that is our firm downstroke. Now, it's also got this really wonderful strike right on beat three of the timpani, right? So just a big, fat, loud A, right? And he says dry, right? Secco. He just really wants this to be just a very, very, like, fast, dry sound, but still very loud. And, of course, it is coinciding with this A here. It's the same exact pitch in terms of, you know, concert pitch. It's the same exact pitch. All right, so those are our booms, right? Boom, ba, boom, da-da-dum. All right. So this this little sweep up here, piccolo, and three flutes, right? And then we've got the G flute. Now, you know, this, if this were, you know, this is basically just, you know, I mean, it's just a G, right? Like, just remember what your G transposition is, right? So it sounds down a fourth, right? So this is just really a G. And, you know, the thing about this is that, like, I don't think there's anything about this G flute part that could not be played on just a standard C flute. But I feel that playing this kind of stuff on the alto flute is something that, like, just keeps the instrument warm, because, like, the second most important alto flute solo of the entire piece is coming up, right? So, you know, in this case, Stravinsky is just following my dictum of, you know, holding onto your auxiliary, right, and not letting go of it, right? Don't just change over to a C flute just because it's more convenient. In this case, those high C's, not high, high C's, but those C's above the staff, written C's above the staff, are easily playable by the alto flute. And this, you know, this flutter-tonguing stuff, if it wasn't surrounded by everything else, right, it's basically doubling the lower flute in this group here, right? If you just work out what all of the transpositions are, you can see that this part is really just the same concert pitch as this, right? So it's just, yeah. But all the same. Okay, now, here's another thing, that this shrieking sound, there's only got one piccolo on it, and that is one thing that I noticed the first time I scored this when I was 16. I was just thinking, wow, that's just one piccolo, right? But the overtones of the three of the A3 flutes put together, plus the piccolo on top of them, is enough to really give that sort of, you know, steam whistle shriek, right? Yeah, and it almost feels like this shrieking is almost like, you know, what the girls would be shrieking. You know, it's not just representing motion, but it also sort of seems to be like a cry, you know, like a cry to their god Yarilo, I guess that's who they're worshiping. And then, you know, so ba-wump, so the first chuck is, you know, basically all the oboes plus cor anglais, English horn, and then the horns playing written A flat, so concert D flat, which is the same as the C sharps, right, that we're seeing in the other instruments, right, plus D and E flat, right, which are concert G and G sharp, right? So we've got that same thing as what's happening here, the G and the G sharp. That is just such a cool chord. Anyways, so that's played by the lower horns, okay? And then they come together in this massive unison, just, you know, ba-da-dum, right? And then, of course, joining them in on this is like all the clarinets. And, you know, all five clarinets, all five, or single reeds, if you wanted to put it that way. All five oboe family instruments. But no bassoons needed. All they're needed for is just this big boom, right? And interestingly, the trumpets are just doing a hit, but they're not really doing anything else, right? Now, as to the strings, they're basically just supporting elements of the harmony in a sense, right? So, you know, if you've got this diminished fifth here, right? We've got that same idea here with the C sharp octave and a fifth plus the G natural. Right? We just got that same internal dissonance in it, right? That you see here. That's sort of, these are just basically just the same pitches, right? You know, expressed as D and E flat being expressed here as G and G sharp, right? And this is also a C sharp fifth if your alto clef reading is bad, right? So yeah, what I think is really, really cool is this rip right here in the cellos. That just really makes it for me. So you basically have got this stack, you know, all the cellos just really hitting this, and on top of it, the three flutes hitting that together, right? So that is two octaves higher. Okay, and then the horns are basically doubling the cellos right here, right? So that just really makes a beautiful combined sound, right? So anyway, so that is the orchestration of this bar. Now this bar is going to reappear, like I said, over and over again in different shapes, like here adding two eighth beats to the beginning of it just to, you know, make it go da 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 da. Okay, now let's talk about these other two bars of section A, right? Okay, so you've got your heavy bass drum. I keep wanting to say grand casa. Your heavy bass drum, you're just going boom, 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 boom. Now notice he's saying poco sforzando. He doesn't want this to be a bass drum solo. He wants this to support the staccatissimo of the cellos and double basses, right? And notice he's giving just an extra little oomph at the there. He just wants to, you know, just to really so you feel the downbeat, right? And what's really cool here is the rhythm of this, right? It's going boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, boom, dun, 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 dun. I just really love that boom, boom thing. Yeah, I just really, really think that's so cool. So those are actually that's a very simple orchestration, right? It's just unison on that A, right? And these, remember, like with the transposing octave transposition for the basses, this makes this concert A at the bottom of the treble, or sorry, bottom of the bass staff, just as written here. Okay, so, and then the chucks are all just basically, you know, same thing as before. You know, you've got your G octaves in the firsts and your C sharp octave in a fifth. In the seconds, and then your C sharp fifths in the violas, right? And that's basically the same exact doubling in the oboes and to a degree of the in the horns, right? So notice that here we've got the written D natural and the written A flat, right? So this D natural and this A flat over here played here. So you don't really have the really high kind of spiky part of the chord, Now, notice that from time to time, there is some variety between these two bars, right? So, like, for instance, here we've got the A flat on top. Here we've got the G natural on top, right? Okay, and then same thing here, A flat, G natural, A flat. There's just tiny little bits of variety thrown in there, so it just isn't so incredibly, you know, repetitive and boring. So now let's look at this other sort of chunka kind of exploration here. And this is basically setting up, these elements are going to come back in section C, okay? Some of these elements. It's going to be written a little differently. But notice the timpani here. The timpani is basically, this could be played by two different players, right? And notice that Stravinsky has actually decided which kettles he wants the players to use, right? So a B sharp, right there on the bottom of the first kettle is really kind of detuning that high kettle. So, you know, it might be a case where the players might opt to just have a second number two kettle. I don't know, but you'd have to ask a timpanist about that. But anyhow, so this is basically the same note as C, right? Okay, and D sharp, kind of the same as E flat, and then we've got this F sharp down here. So this is kind of a very twisted version of that little motive that we heard at the beginning. Remember, dun 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 dun. So it's kind of dun dun do 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 do. Or it's a very, very heavy metal here kind of idea. Okay, and this is going to be slightly doubled. Some of these pitches are doubled here in the bassoons, right? We've got this bevy of three bassoonists just going back and forth on these massive little bassoon chords. These pitches are being doubled by the strings. So it gives a really just a very, very biting sound, especially when you have the horns kind of jumping in and doing their own kind of doubling. So remember, bass clef, everything is up a fourth, right? So sort of similar pitches written out. So this would be, you know, think of this as F natural being the same as E sharp and so on. So yeah, so we've got doubling on the, you know, on the downstroke, right? So it's up, down, up, down, up, down. And then, of course, this time with timpani and the bass drum, right? Okay, and what's more is as we rip up here, we've got the, with the triangle beater, we've got a glissando across the tam-tam. So it has this zhing kind of a sound, or actually just sort of zhing, and it, you know, kind of, it's hard to describe. If the player cuts off right here, like obeys this rest and cuts it off, then you just hear this zhing. Right, and it really kind of is exciting in this push. Now, every once in a while I've heard people opt to just let it, you know, let the probably the conductor has made that decision rather than the percussionist. So it's just allowed to resonate, and that can be very exciting too. But it sort of obscures the sound, a sort of pure sound of just the, you know, of the horns, bassoons, strings on their, you know, on their fourth string. Like almost all of this for the violins through the violas is all played on the fourth string, the heaviest string, right? And with the cellos, it'll be played on the third or fourth strings, generally speaking. So anyhow, very heavy and dense sound, and yet just really like fast and furious, and not heavy in a way that it slows things down, right? It's just extremely vital and active. Now, the only thing we haven't really talked about is how this rip intrudes itself into the we talked about it rhythmically, but just notice how, like, if you look at the structure of, you know, of these bars, you'll see that Stravinsky basically just insinuates the upwards rip across, you know, starting with clarinets, then going into, you know, working its way up through the double reeds and then the flutes on top of that. So it doesn't quite interrupt, you know, the power of the hit, right? So that is just still kind of taken for granted. But, you know, if you listen really closely, you will hear that there's slightly less ferocity to, you know, to this hit here. And then, of course, there is a big rip. And if you know your harmonic series, then you can work out, right, that this is like the fifth and then the sixth and then the seventh and then the eighth and so on, that these are ripping up over over those. It's missing the F sharp, though, right? That that very high partial, the 11th partial. But anyway, so it's just ripping up through those partials and then hitting this just very furious chord here with, you know, all the trumpets and the trombones and, of course, all of the horns. And you know, like a similar kind of idea in some ways to this idea here. You know, you've got the octave with the diminished fourth and the perfect fifth in it, right? So there's some similarities here where you've got your, you've got your minor second in the middle, right? It's a different chord, all right? But there's something similar about the whole construction. I don't have time to work, you know, to work through the whole harmony with you right now. But there's, Stravinsky wants you to not feel a consonant harmony there, all right? He just wants to, but the chord is very well constructed for just huge impact, right, on the ear, on the spirit. This is my feeling. This is using harmony more as a percussive idea than as part of the structure of a piece. It's part of a sort of a theoretical approach. All right, so here we have another big rip. Okay, and essentially it's very similar to the last one, except it's like mostly in flutes. And notice that this time the oboes do fingered tremolo rather than following along or pushing the rip from the bottom. Now, we do have the clarinets joining in on the rip here and then going up to a trill, right? Sort of taken over by the piccolo clarinet and the third, right? So the first and second rip and then the third does a trill, right? And then all through this, the bass clarinet is up fairly high, right? So this is, down a ninth. This is a C, the sort of middle C sharp, right? And then you have like the same thing. And what's interesting here is that both of these rips are done as staccatissimo. So here it's interpreted as flutter tonguing, and here it's just, you know, right? Okay, and it really does have, you know, when you have this push from the bottom with the trombones and then the trumpets, sort of filling in this triplet from below, it really does have a tremendous amount of push. I also like this too, just, you know, the glissando push from a low A up to a high E flat. That is really, really cool. So just really, really nicely done. And then we're back to the same chunka, chunka, chunka. And I explained all the construction of this. And so it's exactly the same thing again, right? And then we're back to a bum, 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 but with the interruption of the flutter tonguing push up to this thing. And it's exactly the same thing again, right? Okay. And then chunka, chunka, chunka. All right. And then here he introduces a new element to section A, and it's bum 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 dum ba-da-dum, right? So it's almost like an introduction to the main idea of the beginning of the glorification. It's sort of like quartal harmony, except that the top element of it is like augmented, right? So you've got a perfect fourth on the bottom, and then you've got your augmented fourth on top, right? And it just really makes a really, really cool sound. And that is basically, you know, given like a kind of a full harmonic treatment by the upper strings and the oboes and the horns. And that I feel that like strings, oboes, and horns in hits, that is something that people don't do enough, right? That's one element. But actually, when you see or when you hear this, like I would say, like, really pay close attention to this as it goes through. It has this really wonderfully round sound, and yet it's devastatingly heavy, right? I think it has this wonderful quality to it, and I don't really see it that much in scoring. I think I've heard John Williams do it a few times, but it's, you know, it's the same idea, especially when, once again, using harmony in a rhythmic way, right? You know, just using chords that have a certain bite to them. Let's see what's on the next page. Yeah, it's just a longer, you know, a longer bum bum dun 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 bum dun 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 bum dun 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 dun, right? So you know, you can see just the cutting and pasting is very, very severe. And, you know, that was something that the, you know, French audience was just not used to, right? Nowadays, it is like stock in trade, right? For sections just to do what they need to do and to be cut together, slashed together. It's sort of like editing in a film, right? You know, you just like one scene follows the next, or one camera shot follows the next without anything in between, without any dissolves, without anything. They just jumps from one to the next, right? Jump cuts, basically, are what these are. And, you know, back then, you know, one thing had to flow into another. And if things came to an end, you know, the ending had to be set up harmonically and in terms of people's expectations. And if, you know, if you pulled the rug out from under the listener, then they would either be like surprised by it in a happy way or infuriated by it. The rest of this score analysis has been posted over on Patreon for further study. Thanks for joining me for another lengthy preview. And I'll see you next month with a look at the Rite's premiere and analysis of the ritual action of the ancestors.